Roscoe Arbuckle started his career as a singer in vaudeville, where it was a tradition on amateur nights to yank on popular acts off the stage with a shepherd's crook, like a gong show. On one particular occasion, his songs weren't going down well, and he dodged the hook and ended up in the orchestra pit, getting a huge laugh, and a comedy star was born. Roscoe started his film career at the Selig Polyscope Company in a short called Ben's Kid, before moving to Universal to star in Max Sennett's popular Keystone Cop comedies. He soon became a breakout star and made a series of two reelers under a nickname he hated but would stick with him throughout the rest of his career. Fatty. He had the distinction of working with the three biggest silent comedians, Harold Lloyd, Buster Keaton, and Charles Chaplin, but his name is rarely mentioned among theirs these days. At the height of Prohibition and his fame, just having signed a lucrative contract with Paramount Pictures, Roscoe took a rare weekend off to visit San Francisco, an open city where the bars were still serving.
This is the Arbuckle reception room. This is Lau Sherman. And this is Fred Fishback. They're Roscoe's travelling companions. Lau's bedroom is off to the left, and Fred is sharing with Roscoe off to the right.
And I'm standing in the reception room between the two bedrooms.
At 11 o'clock, a friend of Fred Fishback arrives at the Arbuckle suite.
This man, a dressed salesman, tells Roscoe that he's just seen an actress called Virginia Rapp at his hotel and wonders if he knows her. Roscoe does, and Fred Fishback phones Virginia and invites her over. Virginia Rapp was a bit part player who was yet to achieve the giddy heights of fame and fortune. Roscoe invites her in to what was quickly becoming a party Roscoe didn't particularly want. Waiting downstairs in the hotel lobby was a woman who Virginia had only met the day before, one Maud Delmont.
Maud Delmont was known as a bigamist and had a criminal record for extortion, prostitution and blackmail. But at Rappe's insistence, she was invited up.
After an hour or two of heavy drinking, Maud catches the eye of Lau Sherman. He follows her into his bathroom. After more alcohol is consumed, Virginia feels unwell and heads for the bathroom adjoining Lau Sherman's bedroom. But Maud Delmont and Lau Sherman are busy, and Maud tells Virginia to use the other bathroom adjoining the other bedroom. She passes through the living room and into Roscoe's bathroom, where she's physically sick. A few minutes later, Roscoe, who has an afternoon appointment, makes his excuses and leaves the party. He finds Virginia, assumes she's had too much to drink, and places her on the bed. He then shaves and has a quick bath in preparation for going out. This takes 10 minutes. When he finishes, he sees that Virginia has been sick again, and he quickly tells the other guests.
This girl's really sick in here. I think she needs some help.
Lau Sherman and Maud Delmont come from the other bedroom to see what's going on.
Roscoe calls the reception for someone to attend to Virginia Rappe.
The hotel doctor arrives and examines Virginia and concludes that she is suffering from excess alcohol. And how many are later, a female nurse will also examine her and find no evidence of any physical injury. Nevertheless, Virginia's condition worsened, but she was not taken to hospital for another 3 days, where, 24 hours later, she died.
Rappe died of peritonitis caused by a ruptured bladder, but that was not what the police or press were told. You see, unbeknownst to the guests, Maud Delmont was also known as Madame Black, known for finding young women for wealthy gentlemen's parties, whereupon the host would suddenly find themselves accused of the worst sort of assault, and Delmont extorting them for money. Seeing an opportunity to make some cash from a big star, she told anyone who would listen that Roscoe had burst Rappe's bladder under his massive girth when he forced himself upon her. Arbuckle was back in Hollywood, unaware of Virginia's passing, when he was charged with her murder. If he was found guilty, he would be sentenced to death. William Randolph Hearst's papers had a field day sensationalising stories, Hearst later saying that Fatty's arrest sold them more papers than the sinking of the Lusitania. The charge was eventually dropped to manslaughter before going to trial in 1921. Maud Delmont was never called to testify as she was considered such an unreliable witness, and Buster Keaton was advised not to stand as a character witness lest he hurts his own career by association. The jury deliberated for 5 days, and with a 10-2 not guilty verdict, meaning a hung jury, he would have to be tried again. The second trial started in January 1922 with a new jury, but because Roscoe's counsel believed they'd already proved his innocence, he was not asked to take the stand again. The jury returned a 10-2 vote in favour of conviction. Another hung jury. By the time of the third trial, headlines of the newspapers had spun a story of a drinking party into that of a debauched orgy. And William Hayes of the Hayes Code had banned Arbuckle's films from distribution. In the trial, Rapp's full medical past was revealed. It turns out that she had had several abortions, which were not legal at the time, and therefore not performed by medical professionals, and that had left her with ongoing abdominal issues. And she would drink to cope with the pain. The jury took less than 10 minutes to return a not guilty verdict and a formal statement of apology.
We feel that a great injustice has been done him. We feel also that it was only our plain duty to give him this exoneration, under the evidence, for there was not the slightest proof adduced to connect him in any way with the commission of a crime. He was manly throughout the case and told a straightforward story on the witness stand, which we all believed. The happening at the hotel was an unfortunate affair for which Arbuckle, so the evidence shows, was in no way responsible. We wish him success and hope that the American people will take the judgment of 14 men and women who have sat listening for 31 days to evidence that Roscoe Arbuckle is entirely innocent and free from all blame.
But the damage to Roscoe's career had been done, mainly by the papers. He would get some work behind the camera directing under the name William Goodrich, but it was a world apart from his heyday. It was a full 10 years after the trial before Roscoe was given a chance at a comeback. He made 6 short films, which were, to the studio's surprise, well received. He was then given the opportunity to make a feature film, but would die of a heart attack before it could be made. He was 46. This was the first Hollywood scandal. But it's interesting to note that pretty much every scandal thereafter has followed a similar pattern.
700 million, are you listening? Most of what you read is made of lies.
A friend asked me what I'd seen recently, and I'd said I'd watched and rather enjoyed the 2004 film Beyond the Sea. My friend hadn't heard of it, so I told her it was the biopic of the singer Bobby Darin, written, directed and starring Kevin Spacey. My friend's face turned to shock. She couldn't believe I would still watch a film with that star. This is fairly recent news at the time of recording, so should still be fresh in everyone's memory, but Kevin Spacey is the 2-time Oscar winner known for playing weirdos, creeps and villains in some excellent films throughout the 90s and early 2000s. Until the Me Too movement went viral in 2017, exposing hundreds of accounts of sexual misconduct in the motion picture industry. The biggest perpetrator of which was film producer Harvey Weinstein, formerly of Miramax. I don't doubt that a change of attitude was needed in Hollywood, and the Me Too movement did some good. But looking back on that time from the safety of 2024, I can't help but think of the Eric Hoffer quote. Every great cause begins as a movement, becomes a business, and eventually degenerates into a racket. There were a lot of lawyers getting very rich around this time, and the press delighted in ousting every new celebrity exposed. Some of whom were proven to be monsters, others, it seemed, were just caught in the crossfire. But it was during this time that Kevin Spacey was accused. BuzzFeed ran a news article attributed to the journalist Adam B. Vary, in which the actor, Anthony Rapp, best known to me at least for starring in Rent, but apparently he was in some Star Trek series I haven't seen. But Anthony Rapp accused Kevin Spacey of making sexual advances towards him when he was merely 14. The article explains that Rapp, and an unnamed 17-year-old friend, met Spacey as he was in a show at the same time as the child actor, and they were invited to join Spacey at a nightclub. At some point during that night out, Rapp was invited to attend a party at Kevin Spacey's New York apartment a few nights hence. The article goes into a lot of details about the sexual advance while being really vague about the who, where's and when's of the story. Rapp alleges showing up at the party to see that it was a very adult event, and deeply uninteresting to his 14-year-old self. So he slunk off to the bedroom to watch television. Sometime later, after the other guests have left, Spacey enters the bedroom and picks Rapp up like a bride and places him on the bed, and then gets on top of him. Rapp wriggles his way free and heads to the bathroom, where he composes himself. He then makes his excuses to his inebriated host and promptly leaves. Were the two protagonists of this story not both stars, or were Rapp an adult at the time the story was alleged to have taken place, 1986, then perhaps this story would not have filled as many column inches as it did. But it was everywhere. Spacey issued a ham-fisted statement in which he said he had no memory of the events Anthony Rapp recounted to BuzzFeed, but if they had happened, he owed him an apology. And then he officially came out as gay. The statement was a work of Spacey and a group of advisors, trying to mitigate damage in a time when the world was incredibly sensitive to such matters. I would speculate that Spacey and his people felt that saying, "if I did behave as described," denied his involvement without diminishing the seriousness of the accusation. When your average reader saw the words, "I owe him the sincerest apology," and thought, "you don't apologise for stuff you don't do, ergo, he must be guilty."
"You solemnly swear and affirm that the testimony you are about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?"
"I do."
Netflix fired Spacey from their hit series, House of Cards, in which he was the lead. This Guardian article states that 8 then current or former workers on the series claimed that Spacey made the production a toxic workplace. One ex-employee alleged that the actor assaulted him sexually, but the details of this matter were not released to the public, leading those who read about his firing to assume the worst. Kevin Spacey was subsequently edited out of the Ridley Scott film All the Money in the World, with his scenes being refilmed by Christopher Plummer. And a biopic about the life of Gore Vidal was cancelled outright, despite being completed and ready for release.
"In July 2016, actor Kevin Spacey has sexually assaulted my son."
Heather Unruh is a former news anchor from Nantucket, and she accused Spacey, in a press conference, of plying her 18-year-old son with alcohol and being inappropriate.
"Spacey stuck his hand inside my son's pants and grabbed his genitals."
But this is where the story takes a strange twist. Unruh's son had lied to Spacey and said that he was of drinking age, and while drunk, he sent a series of text messages to his girlfriend giving a blow-by-blow account of the encounter with Spacey. The police examined a digital copy of the phone and found that several messages had been deleted. They asked the family for the physical phone, and they said they could not find it. A recovery of the messages on the digital copy of the phone showed that Unruh's son had, according to attorney Alan Jackson, coerced and exaggerated the events in order to impress his friends.
"The accuser's mother, former TV news anchor Heather Unruh, admitted in court that she deleted content from her son's phone. Chief investigative reporter Cheryl Fiandaca, who is also a lawyer, explains that could open Unruh up to potential legal trouble."
"If you understand that you take the stand and you offer testimony that incriminates you, you could face prosecution. You understand that?"
"Yes."
Heather Unruh admitting under oath that she deleted photos and videos in her son's phone before she turned it over to police.
"It was not relevant to the case. I didn't touch anything that was relevant to the case."
"Ms. Unruh, you were not the gatekeeper, were you? The police were the gatekeeper. And God forbid, we might be the gatekeeper or the judge might be the gatekeeper. You understand that, right?"
"I'm beginning to understand that now."
"You don't get to pick."
She deleted the information that was on the phone, despite knowing how valuable the evidence was to the case.
"No one wants that phone more than we do."
"Well, I beg to differ."
"No, it's central to the case."
No one knows where the phone is, and the accuser's family doesn't remember getting it back from police. Spacey's attorney says Unruh's testimony today could open her up to potential criminal prosecution.
"It is illegal to in any way delete, alter, manipulate any object, any data, anything."
Unruh's son at first did testify and said he didn't delete messages that Spacey's attorneys claim could potentially exonerate the actor.
"I have no knowledge of any deletions of messages on my phone."
Spacey's accuser, the only witness in the case, later exercised his Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination. And the only physical evidence, the phone, is still missing. The actor's lawyer says he plans to file a motion to dismiss. Cheryl Fiandaca, WBC News.
It's strange that one would announce this at a press conference rather than just litigating. Also, it's very strange that the accuser would plead the fifth in order not to incriminate himself. This is the prosecution, that's not Spacey. I'm sure it comes as no surprise that the case collapsed. There was also a case where a masseuse claimed to have been groped by Spacey during a massage. This case never went to trial because the masseuse sadly died of cancer before his day in court. So this will forever stay unverified. However, the Anthony Rapp case was tried, but not filmed for the public, and the defence found that there were a lot of holes in Anthony Rapp's story. One was Kevin Spacey was living in a studio apartment at the time, so there was no bedroom as Rapp testified there was on the stand. Also, the events, as recounted by Rapp, bore more than a passing resemblance to the scenes in the play in which he was acting at the time, Precious Sons, which, apparently, I haven't seen it, has a scene where a father carries his son to bed, like a bride, and because of his inebriation, momentarily confuses his child for his wife and gets on top of it. Furthermore, subpoenaed text messages revealed that Vary had not so much reported Rapp's story as he had helped craft a deliberately vague story which painted Spacey as a predator, going back and forth with Rapp to hone the details. The 17-year-old, unnamed in the BuzzFeed article, who met Spacey at the same time as the 14-year-old Anthony Rapp, was revealed to be Doctor Who actor John Barrowman, who, contrary to what the article said, was not 17 at the time, but 19, and for some reason, only known to Adam Vary, was not contacted to give his side of the story at the time of publication. He did take the stand, and he said that he and Spacey had flirted, but nothing inappropriate had happened between them. And Barrowman had even sent him flowers as a thank you for the night.
The civil trial verdict is in for actor Kevin Spacey. A New York federal court jury siding with Spacey, finding that he did not sexually abuse actor Anthony Rapp back in the 1980s. The claims by Rapp and others brought an abrupt halt to the Academy Award winner's career. The verdict came after jurors deliberated for just over an hour, not very long. Rapp claimed that he was psychologically damaged after Spacey made a sexual advance in 1986 when he was 14. Spacey testified the encounter never happened, said he was sure of it. Today's verdict ends the civil trial and the lawsuit in which Rapp was seeking up to $40 million in damages.
Now on to the UK trial. Three men accused Spacey of grabbing them. I think you already know where. And one more man accused him of performing oral sex on him against his wishes. One of the groping events was supposed to have happened on the way to a party held by Elton John, which it turns out Kevin Spacey had not attended.
Elton John testifying shortly after his husband, David Furnish, and basically said that Kevin Spacey did not attend the couple's annual white tie and tiara ball party at their home in Windsor the year Spacey's accuser said he was attacked. In fact, the man in question has been saying that really in 2004 or 2005, that was when Spacey had, and I do want to sort of issue a bit of a trigger warning here as I'm going to describe a sexual assault, had aggressively grabbed his crotch while the two were driving to the ball, saying the Oscar-winning actor had grabbed him so forcefully that he almost drove off the road. Now, both Furnish and John testified that Spacey did not attend the annual party at their Windsor home the year the accuser said he was attacked, with Furnish saying that he had reviewed photographs taken at the party from 2001 to 2005 and that Spacey only appeared in images in 2001. Furnish also said that Spacey's appearance was a big deal that year, saying, quote, he was an Oscar-winning actor and there was a lot of buzz and excitement of him being at the ball, with John saying that he only remembered Spacey coming once to the gala. So that was the testimony from those two very big names in this case, which is still ongoing.
To quote from this Guardian article, Spacey told the court that he had consensual encounters with a driver and an aspiring actor, and he may have made a clumsy pass at a man at a party in the Cotswolds, but he rejected the claims that he had grabbed a man's crotch like a cobra at a West End theatre in the mid-2000s, telling jurors it never happened.
Spacey took to the stand and called himself a, quote, big flirt. He also testified that his friendship with one of the accusers was, quote, intimate and, quote, somewhat sexual, and the accusations were a, quote, stab in the back. Spacey has pled not guilty to all counts. He denies the allegations of non-consensual activity.
British trials are not televised. In fact, you're not even allowed to draw those drawings whilst court is in session. So little footage exists of this case outside of the news footage. But Kevin Spacey's legal team must have been convincing.
If all the world's a stage, Southwark Crown Court is 1,000 miles from Hollywood. The relief for Kevin Spacey palpable in the air as the double Oscar winner was cleared of 9 sexual assault charges. The man famous for Shakespearean monologues instead delivering a short and sobering statement.
I imagine that many of you can understand that there's a lot for me to process after what has just happened today. But I would like to say that I'm enormously grateful to the jury for having taken the time to examine all of the evidence and all of the facts carefully before they reached their decision. And I am humbled by the outcome today.
Personally, I was very surprised upon hearing the result. I remember saying, and I thought Usual Suspects had a shocking twist. But when I look back on it, why did I think that? Was it because Kevin Spacey always played a bastard on screen? If I'm honest, I think that might have coloured my opinion subconsciously. Despite the fact I know how movies work, I know he's playing a character. But what definitely did influence my opinion was the fact that Kevin Spacey was ordered to pay $31 million to Netflix because he was fired from House of Cards. But as I said before, the details of that case were not released to the public. No one outside of those involved knows how that was arbitrated or to how that figure was arrived.
I suppose this is a problem maybe with media reporting or due process, but it hadn't even entered my mind that he might be able to clear his name or that he might not have done these things. And I bet I'm speaking on behalf of most people. Is that a problem? Do you think that's a problem that people like me, it's not even entered our minds?
You mean in the sense that you've read it, therefore you feel that it seems to be true, therefore. I think it's because of that. I mean, with great respect to you, I think it's because of that that he needs to do this.
On the left-hand side of the screen is the YouTuber Daniel Shensmith of the legal analysis channel Black Belt Barrister, and not Sean Atwood, as the subtitle hard-coded into the video suggests. On the right-hand side of the screen is Andrew Gold, a journalist who has made documentaries for the BBC, but has also got his own interview channel called Andrew Gold Heretics.
So those that are absolutely sure that he did this, what I would say to you is, you don't know, because you haven't seen the evidence, and you cannot know for sure. The only way you would know for sure if you heard all the evidence presented and then all the defense to rebut that evidence and then come to a decision. And that's why we trust the jury. That's right, the only way you can be sure.
I've got two parts of my head now. I've got one of them's going like, what you've just said is the right thing. And then the other, the more emotional side is going, yeah, but he did it.
It must be true,
I don't believe it is conspiratorial to think that the motivation for Spacey's firing from House of Cards and his removal from all the money in the world was probably financial rather than ethical. I don't know what I should think about Kevin Spacey these days. I still believe him to be a great actor, but it also sounds like he is, should we say, handsy? But every opportunity he has been given to legally do so, he has proved himself innocent. And I mean proved himself innocent, rather than the prosecution not having enough evidence to find him guilty. And that should count for something. I have no idea how his career is going to go looking forward, but I do know that I'd really like to see that Gore Vidal movie.
I live across the street from the Metropolitan Museum of Art, which is this fabulous museum of art. And when I was younger, I used to hang out a lot at the museum in search of a meaningful social relationship or some. I used to look for girls at the museum. And I saw on the wall once a nude by Rubens, but a real succulent nude. A naked huntress stabbing to death a warthog. And I got very emotionally involved with the painting, you know. Two gods had to restrain me. Tried to lick some of the oil off the canvas. So I was thinking to myself, at that time, where is it that I could meet the kind of girl that would pose for that type picture? And in my neighborhood, there's an art supply shop that deals in offbeat things. And I run down there, and I get the name of an artist model off the wall. And I call her up. And I came on very strong like an artist. You know, I used a lot of very artistic terms like brush, I said, and easel. I was just adorable. And We agreed on a price, you know, and hung up. And I got all dressed up in my smock and beret, you know, and little Harvey's Bristol cream on the hair. You know? I'm too much when I want to be. And I waited there. Now and later, there's a knock on my door, and standing there is this fabulous woman, but really sensational. And I let her in quickly, you know, and I lock the door with my police lock immediately. And I said to her, take off your clothes right away, because I don't know much about art, but I know what I like.
There are two scandals surrounding Woody Allen which get rolled into one, as one seems to have begat the other. But there's also a hell of a lot of misinformation which gets repeated so often that it gets confused for fact.
He's done some weird shit.
He definitely has.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no doubt about it. He married a stepdaughter.
Nope. No, he didn't. Not even close. But we'll get into that in a minute. Woody Allen is a four-time Oscar-winning writer and filmmaker who started his career as a genre-redefining stand-up comedian. He has directed 50 movies, including gag-filled comedies, Scandinavian-style dramas, twisting thrillers, and even a musical. But when his name's brought up, it's always one thing which seems to be mentioned.
Now, he is, as he has been for decades, the toast of Hollywood. In fact, Woody Allen's just been honoured by the Golden Globes with a Lifetime Achievement Award. But his adopted daughter, Dylan Farrow, has written an open letter to the New York Times with disturbing allegations that the director sexually assaulted her when she was seven. Allen was investigated at the time but never charged, so why have the claims been revived now? Siobhan Kennedy reports.
The film director, Woody Allen, and his adoptive daughter, Dylan. It was 1989. She was four. Just 3 years later, it was claimed he would take her up into the attic of her mother, Mia Farrow's house, and molest her.
Please let me forewarn you here that the details of this next story are graphic. They're not appropriate if you have children in the room, but
22 years on, and Dylan's given her first public account of what happened in an open letter to the New York Times. In it, Dylan, who's now 28, says,
"He told me to lay on my stomach and play with my brother's electric train set. Then he sexually assaulted me. He talked to me while he did it, whispering that I was a good girl."
The allegations have shocked Hollywood, but they first emerged in 1993, when Allen was in the throes of an ugly custody battle with his partner, Mia Farrow, for their three children, one of whom was Dylan.
"My children have been ripped apart emotionally."
These accusations go back to 1992. And people act like they were swept under the rug, but they had in fact been examined by two independent investigations, and both came back saying that they could not determine a crime had even taken place, let alone Allen was responsible, and the matter was dismissed. These are the major events in order. Sunny is born in South Korea in 1970. 1976, Sunny is found living on the streets and placed in St. Paul's Orphanage, having been abandoned by her birth mother. 1978, she is adopted by Mia Farrow and her second husband, the composer Andre Previn. 1980, Woody Allen and Mia Farrow enter a relationship. They never marry, they never cohabit. According to Farrow's autobiography, he would never spend more than one night in a row in her Connecticut home. 1985, Dylan Farrow is born and adopted at 2 weeks old by Mia Farrow as a single parent. 1991, Woody Allen adopts Dylan Farrow and another of Mia's children, Moses. December 1991, Sunny and Woody Allen enter a relationship. It is not clear when Mia and Woody's relationship ended. Woody's autobiography said it had petered out by this point. Sunny has said that it was over by the time they got together. Mia has said they were still together. 1992, Mia finds out about Woody and Sunny's relationship. And later that year, Mia accuses Woody of the crime in the attic. Woody Allen and Mia Farrow had an odd relationship, and judging by my own standards, a fairly casual one. They would only see each other on and off in the summer months, as Farrow was at her home in Connecticut. In the autumn, they would make their annual movie together, and then winter through spring, they would both be in New York, where they kept their separate residence. Woody Allen was not the father figure to the children Farrow had with Andre Previn, mainly because Previn was still in their lives. Allen was their mother's boyfriend, and one that they didn't see all that often. Sunni says she wasn't even living with Farrow when her relationship with Alan started. She was at college. Personally, if I knew someone in real life who had a relationship with their ex-girlfriend's daughter, it's the first thing I would mention when their name came up in conversation. But that's not the same as marrying your daughter. Because that's illegal. You can't marry your own children, adopted or otherwise.
It usually begins with an emotional domestic breakup, parents fighting over the kids. And then, in the heat of a bitter custody battle, one party charges the other with an unspeakable and frequently unprovable crime, sexually abusing the children. In some cases, no doubt, the allegations are true. In others, a weapon of revenge. It's a story we've done before on 60 Minutes, but this one is different because everyone knows the parents, at least from the movies. The father is Woody Allen, writer, director, actor. The mother is Mia Farrow, his frequent co-star and the mother of his three children, two of them adopted. He is accused right now in the newspapers, perhaps later in a court of law, of abusing their 7-year-old adopted daughter, Dylan. Woody Allen doesn't deny having an affair with 21-year-old Sunyi Previn, whom Mia adopted when she was married to conductor Andre Previn. What he does deny is that last August at Farrow's Connecticut country home, in the midst of a bitter but still private custody fight, he molested 7-year-old Dylan.
The allegations are that you took Dylan into a attic or crawl space, that you touched her in her private part. Is there any truth to that at all?
Look, be logical about this. I'm 57. Isn't it illogical that I'm going to, at the height of a very bitter, acrimonious custody fight, drive up to Connecticut where nobody likes me in the house? I'm with a house full of enemies. I mean, Mia was so enraged at me, and she had gotten all the kids to be angry at me, that I'm going to drive up there and suddenly, on visitation, pick this moment in my life to become a child molester. It's just incredible.
I could get into the ins and outs of this case in great detail, but instead I'll recommend this video by Rick Worley, which does the same thing. And he shows his receipts for everything along the way. But in summary, Mia filmed a confessional video with Dylan in which she talked about the attack. I'm not going to use the video here as the child is in a state of undress, but there were many edits in the video where the cameras turned off and on. This led the investigation to believe that Dylan had been coached to say what she did.
Pisa, that you coached Dylan. Did you ever coach Dylan into making up the accusations of sexual abuse?
Of course not. No, I mean, Dylan was speaking spontaneously and I grabbed a camera. And it is clear, I mean, the judge has seen that tape.
Dylan was said to have a wild imagination and could not discern fantasy from reality. And after a thorough medical examination by the Yale New Haven Hospital, for which she had to be sedated, they ruled she had not been violated.
He's lying, and he's been lying for so long.
The story resurfaced in 2014, while the movie Blue Jasmine was in the middle of its Oscar campaign. Dylan publicly restated her claim against Alan, alerting a whole new audience who were hitherto unaware of the case which happened 20 years before. Now, I don't think Dylan is crying crocodile tears here. I think she's telling what she believes to be true. But memory plays tricks on people. I myself can remember vividly events which turns out I wasn't present for. This is because every time you remember something, you're not recalling the original event. You are, in fact, recalling the last time you remembered it. Things get distorted and embellished very quickly, and it's very easy to implant such a memory on an impressionable mind, like that of a child. But who would do such a thing?
The summer between first and second grades, she was having new wallpaper installed in the bedroom I slept in. Across the hall from hers, on the second floor of the house in Connecticut. She was getting me ready to go to sleep, and when she came over to my bed, she found a tape measure. I didn't even know what it was. She had a piercing look on her face that stopped me in my tracks. It was really scary. She asked if I had taken it. She used that familiar voice I had become attuned to as she explained she had been looking for it all day. I stood in front of her, frozen. She asked why I was on my bed, I told her I didn't know, that perhaps the workmen had left it there. After a couple more demands for the answer she wanted, she slapped my face, knocking off my glasses. She told me I was lying. She directed me to tell my brothers and sisters that I had taken the tape measure. Through my crying and tears, I listened to her as she explained she would rehearse. We would rehearse what should have happened. She told me that she would walk into the room and I would tell her I was sorry for taking the tape measure, that I had taken it to play with, and that I would never do it again. We practiced at least a half dozen times. It became late. I was afraid and had cried myself out. When she was satisfied, she took me to the rocking chair and rocked me. After a short while, she brought me downstairs and made hot chocolate for me before putting me to bed. And that was the start of her coaching, drilling, scripting, and rehearsing.
And who's this? Why, this is Moses Farrow. And who's he talking about? His adoptive mother, Mia Farrow.
Sunyi Previn is breaking her silence in an explosive interview with New York Magazine, saying Farrow emotionally and physically abused her, including slapping her across the face and spanking her with a hairbrush and calling her stupid and moronic. But Previn adds, I was never interested in writing a mommy dearest, getting even with Mia, none of that. Tonight, seven of Farrow's nine children are standing with their mother, including son Ronan, whose investigative reporting helped spark the Me Too movement. Ronan Farrow calling his mother a devoted mom who created a loving home, adding, but that has never stopped Woody Allen and his allies from planting stories that attack and vilify my mother to deflect from my sister's credible allegation of abuse.
Seven of her nine children. Mia Farrow had 14 children, three of whom have died. One by suicide, one by an overdose of prescription medications, ruled to be accidental, and one from complications caused by HIV. That leaves 11. Of course Mia doesn't count Sunyi, so that's 10. That could be a journalistic mistake, or it could be someone playing with the numbers.
Woody Allen. Almost everybody turned their back because he is accused, although not proven to be, and many of us think it's ludicrous that he actually is this thing, a pedophile who started at the age of 57. Okay. But most actors just completely caved.
They caved. It and was so. It was such an.
Scarlett Johansson, God bless her, was like, "Fuck you all." I'll work with him whenever I want to, and you know,
Scarlett Johansson,
so
uniquely
love her for that.
Is intuitively on the right side of almost everything.
Oh, good.
She's a very unique character.
Oh, good.
And someone I have.
Well, that certainly would indicate that to me.
I have deep respect for her. The Woody thing never made sense to me because I've never heard watching Forensic Files of a pedophile who only did it once. So it just never made any sense to me.
Really? A house full of adults.
Yeah. It was.
In the middle of a custody fight.
In the middle of a custody fight with somebody who adopted every child they could find.
Right.
And whose brother was doing time for a pedophile.
Whose brother, exactly. And from a woman who had a giant motivation to be revengeful. No denying the
vengeful.
Yes. No denying
beyond comprehension.
Right. But like, and exonerated by two different, investigations.
HBO cashed in on the resurgence of Dylan's accusations, which had suddenly found traction with a new audience by making one of the trashiest documentaries there has ever been, Allen versus Farrow, which paints Mia Farrow to be Mother Teresa's more saintly sister. At one point, he even accuses Woody Allen of grooming for featuring romances with age gaps in his movies.
You get the feeling watching Woody Allen's films that he's trying to make us acclimated to the idea of these kinds of relationships, this sort of power dynamic, in a sense, grooming us. It's something that he does repeatedly over and over in films, throughout the years, the same archetypes show up, the same kinds of big age gaps in relationships show up. And so when you see it over and over, it kind of attunes you to thinking, this is normal. This is just a thing that people do. It's fine. And there's nothing that I should feel odd about.
I have two problems with this thoroughly stupid take. One, an age gap between people who are above the age of consent is normal. You may not like it. You may have some rule for yourself that you won't date anyone older or younger than X amount of years. But as long as both parties are above the age of consent, then you have no say in it. It's not a crime. And two, if it were a crime, including such things in a work of fiction is not a crime. Should we arrest Martin Scorsese because of all the mobster films he's made?
You talking to me?
Every actor used to want to work with Woody Allen because he wrote great roles, particularly for women, and his films got awards. And at the time this case blew up, the queue of actors waiting to be cast didn't change much. It is my speculation that this is because people knew the story. It was in the press. People could see the accusation didn't hold water. But a renewed interest, 20 years later, led a lot of people, who I doubt had even heard of Woody Allen, to take the claims at face value. And of course, everyone seems guilty if you only listen to the prosecution. I'm not going to stop you if you want to watch these sorts of videos. Personally, my rule is if someone says Woody Allen married his daughter, then that's my cue to bail, as they haven't done the most cursory amount of research. But if you look at the thumbnails on both of these videos, you'll see Allen with a young girl who you're led to believe is Suni. That's actually Suni and Woody's adopted daughter, Boucher. And then there's this one, where Suni's face has been photoshopped to look much younger.
Earlier this year, Dylan Farrow wrote a piece talking about the alleged abuse that she was a victim of, and of course she alleges that Woody Allen had sexually abused her. Well, in that piece, she called out a few celebrities, including Scarlett Johansson, for refusing to speak out against Woody Allen. Now Scarlett Johansson has spoken to The Guardian about the situation, and she hasn't exactly defended Woody Allen, but she does feel that some of the coverage and some of the commentary coming from others regarding Allen is irresponsible. In fact, she tells The Guardian, "I think it's irresponsible to take a bunch of actors that will have a Google alert on and to suddenly throw their name into a situation that none of us could possibly knowingly comment on. That just feels irresponsible to me." She continues, "I think he'll continue to know what he knows about the situation, and I'm sure the other people involved have their own experience with it. It's not like this is somebody that's been prosecuted and found guilty of something, and you can then go, I don't support this lifestyle or whatever. I mean, it's all guesswork."
I'm with her totally. She feels like she got thrown under a bus. Oh, you shouldn't work with Woody Allen because of my allegations. But she's like, look, he didn't get convicted of anything. He says 100% the opposite. You say this. I have no idea who to believe. I agree with her because I don't know who to believe, right? And both sides come out with very convincing stuff, and we're not a court equipped to deal with that, right? I mean, and they had a chance to prosecute him, and they didn't because they didn't have enough evidence.
During the divorce proceedings, there was an investigation. There was an independent investigator who interviewed Dylan Farrow. And remember, she's a child at that point. Interviewed her on six different occasions, and she kept changing her story. And, you know, it's difficult to make a judgment based on that because as a child, you know, you don't know what's going on around you. You don't really understand what's happening. There might have been people in her ear. So it's still really, really difficult to make a judgment call one way or another. And I do agree with you, she was kind of thrown under the bus. It's difficult to say, I'm not going to work with this person anymore based on something that at this moment is a rumor.
Yeah, and look, it might be that she was abused, right? And kids change their stories all the time because they're kids, right? Or it might be that her mom, who's incredibly bitter, and understandably so, against Woody Allen, suggested that. That actually happens a surprising amount of time as well. But it's not up to Scarlett Johansson to figure that out. And you saying that, she, you know, implying basically that she's immoral for working with Woody Allen, I know it's your vendetta against Woody Allen, and if you're right about the allegations, justifiably so, but it involves Scarlett Johansson and the other actors, and it doesn't seem fair.
And I do agree that it is irresponsible to choose sides at this moment. So Lena Dunham, I'm a big fan of hers, but she's an avid supporter of Dylan Farrow. And again, if you don't have hardcore evidence proving that this happened, I think that it's a really dangerous precedent to immediately judge someone based on allegations. Anyone can make an allegation.
See, I think what people sometimes make this mistake, and it bothers me, is that they view the severity of the crime with the degree to which they are certain that that person committed it, mm-hmm. right? So like, well, wait a minute, this is about assaulting a child. You're right, that's an incredibly severe crime. But that doesn't mean that he did it. That gives you no extra certainty that he actually committed that act. If you had that certainty, then I'm 1,000,000% on your
side.
And
let's be 100% clear. We're not supporting Woody Allen, we're not defending Woody Allen, we just don't know.
Johnny Depp is the Hollywood actor that most closely resembles a rock star, starting his career in 1984 in the horror film A Nightmare on Elm Street. He went on to dominate weird and quirky character roles for the next 30 years, until he landed the part of Captain Jack Sparrow in Walt Disney's Pirates of the Caribbean, and his career went stratospheric.
You are without doubt the worst pirate I've ever heard of.
But you have heard of me.
Amber Heard is an actress who has been working regularly since 2004's Friday Night Lights. She was also Johnny Depp's second wife, having met on the set of the adaptation of the Hunter S. Thompson book, The Rum Diary, which is a much better film than its reputation suggests.
You're here because of The Rum Diary, of course, in which you star with certain Mr. Johnny Depp.
Yeah.
How was that with him?
It was torture.
Yeah.
Okay. It was torture. I highly recommend this kind of torture. But, I mean, what an honor. Words fail to articulate what an honor it really is and how grateful I am for the opportunity, because that's what it was. It was a wonderful opportunity. It was such a strong project and such a wonderful cast, and I could not have asked for a better, more rewarding chance.
Their relationship was said to be stormy. As they travelled around the world for their careers, the press reported on several full-blown arguments while Depp was allegedly under the influence of alcohol. Great Britain's best-selling newspaper, The Sun, used the words wife-beater to describe Johnny Depp, and he took it upon himself to sue.
So the critical part is the use of the word wife-beater by The Sun newspaper. Mm-hmm. I'm not a lawyer. I think 20 or 30 years ago, when we heard the word wife-beater, we would have expected it to be a form of behaviour, that it would have happened more than once. At this stage in the court proceedings, Johnny Depp denies any violent assault against Amber Heard at all. Should she says she has proof, well, that's been suggested. If that was to come out and there was one incident, does that make him a wife beater? If indeed this exists, at the moment we don't know.
Yeah.
But the term is so damaging in this day and age. I think that Johnny Depp has taken the view that if it was to be allowed to go unchecked, that would have a long-term damaging effect on his movies. In fact, if you see the Harvey Weinstein Me Too, I mean, that's the end of his production house, and you could easily see the same thing happening to Depp if it's proven. Right. But it's for the Sun newspaper. This is what's fascinating about libel, is it's for the people who make the claim, in this case the Sun newspaper, to prove it's true. So therefore Amber Heard will be their star witness.
Proving libel in the UK is notoriously hard, as the burden of proof is reversed here. The Sun newspaper had to show they had good reason to use those words in an article about Depp.
He was allegedly jealous of Amber's relationship with co-star James Franco, and during a flight on a private jet, flew into a blind rage. This recording was played in court today. It's said to be Mr. Depp on that flight in a drunken stupor.
After listening to the recording, Mr. Depp said he didn't recognise himself. It sounded more like an animal in pain. It's alleged that before he blacked out, he called Amber Heard a slut and a whore before slapping her across the face and kicking her in the back.
Sasha Woss, the barrister representing The Sun, asked him, "Would you call somebody who kicked a woman in the back a wife beater?" Johnny Depp replied, "If someone kicked a woman in the back, I would call them an animal, a savage. It's one of the most disgusting things anyone has ever called me."
Depp also claimed that articles had misquoted or taken out of context remarks made by Catherine Kendall, and The Sun newspaper had failed to correct their writings.
Witnesses included a prominent campaigner in the Me Too movement, Catherine Kendall, one of the first women to accuse Harvey Weinstein of sexual harassment. In text messages to a Sun newspaper reporter, she said she'd been misquoted. "I never meant to be in an article that called Johnny Depp a wife beater," she said. "I told you that I didn't know that to be true at all. I've heard several times that she, in fact, was abusive to him." A secret recording by Mr. Depp's ex-wife, Amber Heard, was played in court of a meeting between her and her interior designer, Laura Devonier. She told Ms. Heard she'd felt manipulated by Mr. Depp's lawyers into giving a statement.
"You know, I didn't know any of this knowledge beforehand. I mean, it was literally afterwards. You always hid it from me."
"It's not your fault you didn't know. I hid it from everyone."
"That's I know.
What Amber- people do."
A friend of Johnny Depp, Isaac Baruch, also gave evidence, describing photos of injuries to Amber Heard as phony baloney. He says she was trying to extort and blackmail him.
The judge ruled the Sun newspaper articles had been substantially accurate on the balance of probabilities. The court did not accept Depp's claim that Amber Heard was not a reliable witness, and Heard maintained that while Depp had always been the aggressor, she had hit him back in self-defense. Johnny Depp lost the case in the UK. He appealed, and it was rejected.
Mr. Depp, you remember giving testimony in the trial in the UK, correct?
Yes.
And you gave that testimony under oath, right?
Yes.
You gave quite a bit of testimony in that trial, right?
I wouldn't be able to judge that myself. I don't, it felt like a lot.
Okay, well, let's take a look at some of it.
2 years later, in Fairfax County, Virginia, Amber Heard would stand trial against Johnny Depp. Depp asking for $50 million compensation, claiming that Amber Heard's defamation of him directly led to a reputational damage and a significant loss in work. And because this trial was taking place in America, the whole thing was allowed to be televised.
No, that's the thing.
You want to see crazy, I'll give you a fucking crazy. That's crazy. Oh, you're crazy. Are you crazy?
Have you drunk this whole thing this morning?
Oh, you got this going. You got this going?
I just started it.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Really?
I watched every single second of the trial as it was streamed live. It was honestly the best thing I've seen Depp or Heard in a long time.
I thought what was most interesting is that she tried to hide it from me, and then that she laughed and smiled at the end. I thought that was the most interesting part myself. But so, yes,
you didn't react.
I did assault a couple of cabins, but I did not touch Miss Heard. And as you can see, I think, no.
And you may have been drunk in that video, correct?
There's a possibility of that, yes, sir.
You poured yourself a mega pint of red wine, correct?
A mega pint?
Yeah.
Every case is tried on its own merits, and the results of the UK trial were of no effect on the American case. Johnny admitted to taking drugs, not regularly, but frequently, and did not deny several moments of rage, but was adamant he did not hit Heard.
The results of Ms. Heard's evaluation supported two diagnoses: borderline personality disorder and histrionic personality disorder.
Would you agree that a disproportionate number of women are tagged with a diagnosis of borderline personality disorder?
No, that's not quite right.
75%?
The way you phrased it is not quite right.
Tell me what's right.
Okay, so there are more women who have been diagnosed with bipolar disorder than men. It's more prevalent in women.
And trauma can cause borderline personality disorders, can't it?
No.
According to the National Institute of Mental Health, the symptoms for borderline personality disorder are efforts to avoid real or perceived abandonment, such as plunging headfirst into relationships or ending them just as quickly, a pattern of intense and unstable relationships with family, friends, and loved ones, a distorted and unstable self-image or sense of self, impulsive and often dangerous behaviours such as spending sprees, unsafe sex, substance misuse, reckless driving, and binge eating. They do have a little caveat here saying, however, if these behaviours happen mostly during times of elevated mood or energy, then they may be symptoms of mood disorder and not borderline personality disorder. Self-harming behaviour such as cutting, reoccurring thoughts of suicide or threats, intense highly variable moods with episodes lasting a few hours to a few days, chronic feelings of emptiness, inappropriate intense anger or problems controlling anger, feelings of disassociation, such as feeling cut off from oneself, observing oneself from outside one's body, or feelings of unreality.
You are not rendering any diagnosis whatsoever of Mr. Depp today or ever.
No, I probably would say to you that certainly I would not say narcissistic personalities or say traits. Certainly from what I have read, intimate partner violence is not a diagnosis. So the answer is no for that. Narcissistic personality traits is not a diagnosis. The answer is no. But if you want to tell me that substance use disorder is a psychiatric diagnosis, the answer is yes. And I.
But that wasn't an issue, was it? Whether Mr. Depp used substances. I mean, you said you've gone through the record. That wasn't really an issue at this trial. He's said it from day one.
Oh, so you're saying he's already admitted to the diagnosis?
He's already admitted to the use of the substances. Oh.
Well, again, there's a difference between admitting to substance use and substance use disorder.
Psychiatrist Dr. David Spiegel was called to testify on Amber Heard's defense and ended up suffering, in his words, a horrific backlash.
A deposition, didn't you say that what you did was compare Mr. Depp's performance in lots of pirate movies against his deposition testimony
what
here?
What I said was I've seen Mr. Depp do apology ads. I remember he did apology ad with Bad Dog with no delay in processing speed. I've seen him interact with the media regarding to that. I saw no delay in processing speed. All I'm saying
Let me ask you about pirates, though. You compared pirates to the depositions given
then
in this case.
Then I apologize for what I said. Then I misspoke.
You misspoke? You didn't make the comparison?
Right now, just a second ago? Just a second ago, I may have said that I misspoke. I apologize, I misspoke.
Okay. Because you know you can't compare pirates to sworn testimony, right?
Yes.
Okay.
But as an aside, you can't judge someone's processing speed at any time. Like I'm judging yours right now, you're judging mine. We all judge processing speed as a baseline because of what we know about each other. I would say your processing speed right now is not slow. So, we're judging processing speed, I'm just saying to you.
Yeah. Any of Mr. Depp's other portrayals in movies, did that affect your analysis of processing speed?
Only I've seen him interact on interviews, right. And that was it.
Right.
When he wasn't in movies.
What, right. But Willy Wonka doesn't matter to you? You see him in that movie, Charlie and Chocolate Factory? Did you look at that one when you were comparing his processing speed?
Do I have to answer that question, Your Honor?
You have to answer questions, yes, sir.
No, you'll be happy to know I didn't see Willy Wonka, I didn't see 21 Jump Street when it happened, or whatever it was about. No, I did not.
Amber Heard was accused of faking the bruising on her face, which she claimed was from physical altercations with Depp.
You testified yesterday. This is another photograph of you on the night of May 21.
That's correct.
And keeping this exhibit up, can we please do a split screen and also pull up Defendant 713, which has already been admitted? Ms. Heard, you testified yesterday. This is also a photograph of you from the same night, correct?
That is correct.
You testified yesterday that the only difference between these two photographs is that the light was turned on.
That's what it appears to be, yes.
The light is on both of these pictures, though. Isn't that right?
It looks to me like the one on the left has the vanity light, the makeup lights, you know, the more yellow-hued ones that go around the mirror on, and then the one on the right looks like it doesn't have those.
Isn't it true you just edited these photographs?
No, I've never edited a photograph.
Didn't you just enhance the saturation for one of these photos to make your face look more red?
No, that's incorrect. I didn't touch it.
Through analysis of the metadata, it was shown that the photographs in question had been manipulated digitally by someone to enhance the colorization.
And Mr. Neumeister, what's your, what do we see here in this demonstrative?
There's Exhibit 712, I believe you have. I'm not sure the Bates number was 712 and 713. They're two separate exhibits, except it's the exact same photograph that's been, one's been edited, one hasn't, or I can't say that one hasn't, but the colors have been modified in an editor.
Objection, Your Honor, beyond the scope of your ruling, talking about colors, it keeps happening.
Thank you, Your Honor. So, Mr. Neumeister, without going into the specifics, what's your opinion about the authenticity of the photos you received from Ms. Hurd?
Based on the way they were collected, there would be
objection, Your Honor. We just ruled on this.
I framed my question, I thought, Your Honor, to avoid the issue that you're concerned about. Mr. Neumeister, what's your opinion about the authenticity here?
There's no way for any forensic expert to validate any of these photos.
Thank you very much. No further questions.
Everyone I knew was gripped to these events as they unfolded, and there were a lot of highlights, far more than I could ever put here.
You didn't know what could cause damage to Mr. Depp's hand while you were there on March 8th, correct?
Dr. Kipper told me he sustained an injury on one of his
fingers. Objection, hearsay.
Wait, you asked the question.
Okay.
Did Mr. Depp push you in any way down the stairs?
No.
Mr. Knight, you are a pretty big fan of Johnny Depp, aren't you?
I am not, to be honest.
You know this case is being televised, right?
I am aware that there are cameras.
And so this gets you your 15 minutes of fame, doesn't
Objection,
it?
Your Honor. Argumentative.
I can ask that question.
Overruled.
So I stand to gain nothing from this. I'm actually putting myself kind of in a target of TMZ, a very litigious organization, and I'm not seeking any 15 minutes here. Though you're welcome to speculate. I could say the same thing by taking Amber Heard as a client for you.
A little argumentative, don't you think?
Oh, hardly. I find that to be purely logical.
Amber Heard was found guilty of defamation, and Johnny Depp was awarded $10 million compensatory damages and $5 million punitive damages. But the total was later reduced to $10 million because of a limit Virginia State has on punitive damage payouts. Amber Heard was awarded $2 million in damages for one of her three counterclaims. About a week after the verdict, Amber Heard did her first interview. This is her talking about the British case.
There was another trial handled dealt with the same substantive issues that had even more evidence in. In fact, my evidence was largely kept out, really important pieces of evidence kept out. Done differently, handled differently by a judge instead of a jury.
Some evidence is admissible in a UK court that is not admissible in a US court.
That there, in a nutshell, is why the results in the UK and US trials were different. Different evidence is admissible in each court. And remember, in the UK trial, Heard was not the defendant. Newsgroup Newspapers Limited was, and Heard was a witness. And by her own admission, a lot of her evidence was not used.
This is not only about our First Amendment right to speak.
But here's the thing about the First Amendment. The First Amendment protects free speech. It doesn't protect lies that amount to defamation. And that was the issue in the case.
Yes, exactly. You can't go into, the free speech does not protect you if you go into a crowded theater and you scream fire. We get the concept of free speech from the Greeks. My understanding of what that means is not just the freedom to speak. It's a freedom to speak truth to power.
The truth is the word.
Yes.
And that was the issue.
And that's all I spoke. And I spoke it to power, and I paid the price.
I know I'm not the smartest guy in the world, but that sounded like utter gibberish to me.
Johnny Depp came to Cannes creating a lot of excitement. He was the star of the opening night film, Jean du Barry, in which he plays French King Louis XV, who falls in love with a social climber portrayed by the Franco-Algerian Mei Wen, who also directed the French-language film.
Johnny Depp's career looks likely to bounce back. Whether it will be as big as it was remains to be seen. He starred in Jean du Barry, his first movie in 3 years, which opened the Cannes Film Festival. But the press only wanted to talk about one thing.
I suggest that before people start pointing fingers and making judgment on others that they have no idea about, I would say take one day off, everybody, take one day off of work, stay home, start your investigation of everyone in your family. Start with your father. Look way back. Dad always been a wonderful guy, has he? Your uncles, look at your brothers. Look around you first before you start passing judgment on someone that you have no idea what that person has been through, who they are.
Amber Heard's career I'm not so sure about, which I think is a shame because even though I haven't seen her in many films, every film I have seen her in, she's been perfectly fine. Same can be said about Anthony Rapp. Mia Farrow is an exceptional actor. I'm not going to stop watching films with these people in just because of some court cases. I'm an advocate for court cases. If you have a credible case, whatever it is, you have a duty to take it to court. But if it doesn't stand up, we can't treat the defendant like they're guilty. Otherwise, what's the point in having a legal system at all? The press love a Hollywood scandal, but happy endings don't sell papers. So Kevin Spacey is arrested is the headline, but Kevin Spacey's cleared of all charges is page 12. These things seep into the mind and you think you know a thing, but that's the definition of conjecture. I've only been able to skim over the surfaces of these stories and I urge everyone to read more about these cases. And please try and force yourself to thoroughly read the side you disagree with. You might see why the result was what it was.
The defendant is not guilty. But somebody in this courtroom is. Now, gentlemen, in this country, our courts are the great levelers. In our courts, all men are created equal.
If you have got this far in the video, please consider clicking that like button and maybe writing a comment. Videos like this get crushed by the algorithm unless you're a big creator, which I'm not. So anything you can do to push its head above the water will be a great help. Thanks. I'm Scott Kingsnorth, and I'm making a movie.